Hello friends. Approximately 4 billion years ago, life began on Earth. After billions of years of evolution, numerous species of plants and animals evolved. All these trees, plants, animals and creatures that you see today, all of them exist due to evolution. One of these species is Homo sapiens, that is, humans. How true is this evolution theory? Is it merely a theory or a fact? And how did these different types of animals evolve? Let's find out in this video. Let's begin with clearing the biggest misconception. Evolution theory doesn't claim that monkeys became humans. Instead, it claims that all chimpanzees, gorillas, monkeys and humans have the same ancestor. And that ancestor is not alive today. But one question that will still linger in your mind is, why did some of our ancestors evolve into humans and some into chimpanzees and some monkeys? Why? You will get the answer later in this video. In the year 1859, Charles Darwin wrote the historic book On the Origin of Species. In this book, he talked about the theory of natural selection. According to this theory, whenever there is reproduction, whether it is in humans, animals, trees or plants, genes pass on from one generation to another. Our genes pass on to our children. But the genes pass on with certain mutations. There are slight changes in the genes. You can see some variations. And these variations are often inherited by future generations. Often, these variations are beneficial and harmful, depending on the environment. Some survive and some die out. This process is called natural selection. Let's understand how evolution happened. On the tree of evolution, if you go back in time, you will find common ancestors with every species. Humans and monkeys have a common ancestor. Humans and cows and buffaloes have a common ancestor. All animals and trees and plants have a common ancestor. If we go back in time, it began approximately 4 billion years ago. The Earth was very different at that time. There were no continents on Earth. Earth was covered with only water. And this water is where life began. Scientists have given a very simple name to this first organism. They have called it the first universal common ancestor. In short, it became FUCA. At that time, there were no genes, no DNA. 3.8 billion years ago, FUCA evolved into a unicellular organism. We call it LUCA, last universal common ancestor. All the living things on Earth, trees, plants, animals, bacteria, and fungi, all of us have a common ancestor, LUCA. Scientists believe that it must have been a prokaryotic microbe with a cell membrane. Scientists have estimated that there were about 355 genes in LUCA. In July 2016, William Martin, scientists from the University of Dusseldorf discovered there are 355 genes in every organism living on Earth to date. LUCA is classified as half alive. After millions of years, when LUCA branched out into two, bacteria and archaea. These two microorganisms are very similar to each other. They differ slightly in terms of the cell wall and plasma membrane. Many billions of years later, a very special type of bacteria emerged due to evolution. Cyanobacteria. This was the first bacteria to be able to do photosynthesis, using sunlight to generate energy. Water was used as fuel. And the end product was oxygen. when a lot of cyanobacteria in the ocean used photosynthesis, a large amount of oxygen was released into the air. This event is called the Great Oxygenation Event. This led to the formation of the nucleus in the cell. DNA was kept safe inside the cell so that it could be protected. Some types of cyanobacteria turn into chloroplasts. This is why all plants and trees are able to photosynthesize today. This was the birth of the plant kingdom. On the other hand, since there was an abundance of oxygen in the atmosphere, an ancient bacteria decided to use this available oxygen to generate energy. This was the beginning of aerobic respiration. This bacteria evolved further inside another archaea to form mitochondria, which is now known as the powerhouse of a cell. An important element in all eukaryotes. Later on, these eukaryotes split into three sub-branches. The animal kingdom, fungi kingdom and algae kingdom. The algae kingdom is also called Protista. Initially, there are three branches, bacteria, eukarya, and archaea. And then eukarya branched out into plants, animals, fungi and algae. In each of our bodies, only 43% of the cells in our body are human cells. The rest are bacteria, viruses, fungi, and archaea cells. If we go back to the story, about 900 million years ago, multicellular life was born. It was easier to survive if the cells were in a group instead of being unicellular and alone. About 555 million years ago, we see a common ancestor of all animals. The Icaria wariosa. It was smaller than a grain of rice. It was a bilateral worm which had a front and a back end. So, the scientists found these fossils in South Australia, and when the fossils were carbon dated, they were found to be from a creature that lived 555 million years ago. It was also a bilateral creature. Then the vertebrates, or the spine, started to develop. All fishes, reptiles, birds and mammals are called vertebrates, because they have a spine. The first spine was developed 480 million years ago. It was a fish called Arundospis. After this, organisms started evolving to have four legs. The animals that have four legs are called tetrapods. And this development happened in water. This fish lived 375 million years ago, which is called Euthynopteron. It is a 6 feet long fish, with a very strong jaw and sharp teeth. It is said to be the connection between all the fish and land vertebrates. The Tiktaalik rosy was discovered in 2004. Its big four fins were able to support it to be able to live on the ground. Its skull was like a crocodile, so it could bite and eat. But that doesn't mean that all the organisms moved from water to the ground. Kikiktania wakei fish was a relative of this Tiktaalik. It is believed that it came to the ground for a while, but couldn't adapt to the conditions, and went back to the sea. Some good examples of this are whales and dolphins. Whales and dolphins are mammals. They are more closely related to humans than fish. Unlike fish, they can't breathe underwater. They have to come up to the surface to breathe. This means that dolphins and humans must have had a common ancestor who lived on the ground. Some of the descendants of those ancestors stayed on the ground while some went back to the sea. 368 million years ago, amphibians began evolving. Amphibians are animals like frogs and salamanders, which can live in water as well as on land. Then began the evolution of reptiles. Snakes, turtles, alligators, crocodiles, lizards. Dinosaurs later evolved from this branch. Dinosaurs started coming around 230 million years ago. Moving forward, 225 million years ago, we see this 20 centimeters long animal that looks like a mouse. It is named Brasilodon quadrangularis. It is now considered the oldest mammal in the world. Humans, monkeys, dogs, cats, tigers, lions, all these are mammals. Normally, mammals do not lay eggs. But exceptionally, the mammals that do lay eggs are called monotremes. Today, 5 species of monotremes are alive. One of them is the platypus. Apart from monotremes, there are 2 more branches in mammals. The placentals and the marsupials. Then, 125 million years ago, marsupials and placental mammals evolved in different directions. 40 million years ago, the continents of South America, Antarctica, and Australia were connected. So when marsupials evolved, they spread over these 3 continents. At that time, there was no ice in Antarctica. Antarctica had a forest, too. Maureen O'Leary and her co-researchers said that the first placental mammal was actually found only 65 million years ago. Now we are coming to the most interesting part of the timeline because, at this time, the dinosaurs had already gone extinct. The asteroid had killed all the dinosaurs. A study published in the Science Journal has shown that the boom in placental mammals began only after the dinosaurs went extinct. If this hadn't happened, we would never have seen diversity in placental mammals. Humans would never have existed. At the same time, placental mammals split into different branches. One such branch is that of the ungulate, the mammals with hooves. Cows, buffaloes, pigs, goats, camels, deer, and hippopotamus all belong to this category. This branch was later divided into even-toed and odd-toed ungulates. Apart from these, another branch was formed of the carnivora order. Whales and dolphins are classified as cetaceans and their closest ancestry is with ungulates. Then there was the category of Afrotheria. It includes elephants and this small animal called Hyrax. Evolution does not happen in a linear fashion. It happens in every direction wherever it can fit. There are 4 main reasons. These 4 reasons are known as the 4 forces of evolution. 1 is the genetic mutation. The mistakes while replicating the DNA causes mutations in the genes by chance during reproduction. The second is natural selection. The traits of the genes that naturally fit the ecosystem, the best evolution continues from there. The third reason is the genetic drifts. When a small population of an animal gets isolated and then goes to a place and reproduces. A good example of this can be seen among humans too. The Amish people. Amish people are a small community living in America and Canada. Their population is around 250,000 people. Their ancestors came from Germany and Switzerland around 200 years ago. Interestingly, only around 200 people came to America and Canada. But this community was so conservative that they never married any outsiders. They kept intermarrying within themselves. The result of this is that for the population of these 250,000 Amish people, their ancestors were among those 200 emigrants. One of his 200 original founders was a person with a recessive gene which causes the Ellis von Krefeld syndrome. It's a disease that makes your hands and feet smaller and you have more fingers. Since they kept intermarrying among themselves, this recessive gene kept being passed on. And due to evolution, today, this disease is found proportionately more among Amish people than in any other species globally. So, from the perspective of evolution, genetic diversity is always better. To see intermixing in different types of genes. Now, let's come to the fourth reason, which is gene flow. This is similar to genetic drift, but here a population migrates towards another and there's mixing between the two. So, evolution can take millions of years, as we saw in the case of mammals. But on the other hand, it can take a year or two. A good example of this is the coronavirus. We have seen so many mutations in the SARS-CoV-2 virus since the COVID-19 pandemic started. The Delta variant, the Omicron variant. Evolution is not just a theory, it is a fact. When we use the word theory, it means a scientific theory. A scientific theory is made only when there is ample evidence. Albert Einstein's theory of special relativity, the theory of the Big Bang, and the theory of evolution. They are known as theories, but they are facts. It is estimated that 97% of scientists believe that evolution is the truth. We have the explanations of what happened. After learning about such irrefutable evidence, no sensible person will call evolution wrong. And so we come to the last part of our story. The evolution of primates. Research from 2021 found that the ancestor of all primates must have been alive 65.9 million years ago, coexisting with the dinosaurs. The evolution of primates was a big branch among mammals. It was only after this that we get to see gorillas, chimpanzees, monkeys and humans evolve. All the species that exist today. Trees, plants, animals, all of them exist in an equilibrium. An equilibrium where everyone fits harmoniously. Every species has its place in the ecosystem. Whether it is a blood-sucking organism like a mosquito, a shark or even a scavenger like a hyena, everyone is important in this ecosystem. So, that's all for today. Tell me in comments what do you know about evolution and what's your research on it. If you found this video interesting, like it and share with your friends, and don't forget to subscribe to the Macula for more interesting videos. Thanks.